Low. Testing. I know. Testing.
Stand together this morning as we prepare our hearts for worship. Hallelujah. As we prepare our hearts for worship this morning, how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. So glad to have you with us this morning. And those of you who may be watching us live, we welcome in your presence to our service this morning into the sanctuary here at Kingdom Seekers. Blessed by your presence. Hallelujah. For taking time out of your schedule to spend a little time with us and with God. We don't take that lightly. So let's go before the throne of grace in prayer this morning. Father, thank you so much for your great grace, your loving kindness that you've shown toward us. Thank you, Father, for your goodness and your mercy. As David reminds us that they follow us all the days of our lives. And even though we may be in the valleys of the shadows of death, we're in the valleys of the shadows of death where sickness is around us. Well, even the shadow of death may be able to be near us, but a shadow shall not harm us because thou art with us. Thank you, Father, as we trust you this morning as Lord of our life, that as we trust you as our Savior, as our Redeemer. Thank you, Father, for just your new mercies, because the word says that they're new every morning. Thank you, Father, that we don't deserve it, Father, but you continue to daily load us with benefits. And when we survey ourselves, we find out your benefits are better than Blue Cross Blue Shield, that they're better than a 401k. That you daily continue to be good to us even when we don't deserve your goodness. So, Father, we pause for a moment just to say thank you. We pause for a moment just to say much obliged. because we're grateful to God, because you don't have to do anything. You didn't have to do it, Father, but you woke us this morning, and for that reason alone, we have our faculties and our strength, and there's breath in our lungs, and we'll accept the challenge that David said, let everything that have breath praise ye the Lord. And as long as we got breath in our bodies, we're going to give you the praise. We're going to give you what you rightfully deserve, because you paid it all, and it's all to you that we do owe, Father. We owe the glory to you. We owe the honor to you. We owe to call you holy, Father. We owe it all to you, because you paid it all for us at Calvary, that you shed your blood, Father, so that we might be forgiven for our sins, that if we put our trust in you, God, you sent not your Son in the world to condemn the world, but that through him the world might be saved. And so, Father, we come to this place to look to a hill where old rugged cross stood. And so, Father, we look to that hill. We find strength in that hill, because he never said a mumbling word, Father. He stayed right there. And so, Father, we're grateful to Jesus for his obedience to stay there, because he could have called for 10,000 legions of angels to call to take him down. But he stayed right there because he had us on his mind. And so, Father, it's out of that we stand this morning with you on our mind, because you, God, you've kept us in our right mind, God. You've given us sense to come out into the house of worship, to log in to the house of worship, God. You kept us in our right mind, because you had us on your mind some 2,000 years ago when you hung, bled, and died for the redemption of mankind. And so, Father, we'll do what the word says. We'll let the redeemed of the Lord say so. And because we've been redeemed, we'll open our mouths and we'll bless your name, because we are redeemed. We've been bought with the shed blood of Christ, not with corruptible things such as money, gold, and silver. But God, you paid the price for us at Calvary. And Father, we stand and we say, like the church of old, what could wash away our sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Father, we're grateful this morning for the blood of Jesus. Oh, it reaches the highest mountain and it flows to the lowest valley. It's the blood that gives us strength to run the race. It's the blood that gives us strength from day to day. And so, Father, we thank you for the blood of Jesus. Father, we thank you for what Christ did for us at Calvary. We're grateful recipients of the price that he paid. And so, Father, we say thank you. We say thank you. We say thank you. God, if we had 10,000 tongues, God, we couldn't thank you enough, God. We just couldn't praise you enough, God, because of what you've done for us and what you continue to do for us, oh God. You keep blessing us over and over and over. And oh, when we don't deserve it, God, you continue to bless us, God. When we get sick in our bodies, God, you lay your hands on us and heal us, God. We decree and declare, if there's someone listening today that's sick in their body, God, we decree and declare, as you say, you sent your word and you healed them all, Father. We pray that healing virtue flows in this place this morning. We pray that healing virtue flows out of this place this morning, that somebody might be listening to us, oh God, that may receive that divine touch this morning, oh God. Just one touch from you, God, could change our lives, oh God. God, demons can flee with just one touch from you, God. Sickness can be eradicated in our bodies, God. Cancer can be eradicated. Diabetes can be eradicated. Watch this. COVID-19 could be eradicated, oh God. Just one touch, one word from you, God, and we receive our healing, because you said by every stripe that you took, we're healed, God. We declare we're the healed of God. God, we decree and we declare, God, that, God, all of our bills are paid because we trust you concerning our finances, oh God, because you said you'll give us more. And Father, we believe that there's more in store, oh God, that we hadn't seen the best yet, because eyes have not seen it, ears have not heard all that you have in store for those who love you, Father. And certainly, God, we love you this morning, God. We declare our love for you this morning, God. We declare our love for you this morning, God. We pray, God, that you're going to open up doors this week that no man can close, oh God. That you're going to close doors that no man will be able to open, Father. Thank you for your goodness toward us, oh God. Your loving kindness that you show toward us day by day. God, we don't deserve your goodness. But because of Christ, and because of the price that Christ paid for us, we receive your goodness. God, there may be somebody who's struggling in their minds right now. God, but you are a mind regulator. You said you keep our minds in perfect peace if we keep them stayed on you. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for giving us that love that flows from heart to heart. God, that in this season we don't make our religion selfish, but that we make a conscientious effort to cry out to the world that Jesus is the way, he is the truth, and he is the life. And if we're going to get to the Father, he gives us access. Thank you for a relationship with Christ that gives us access. Thank you, Father. You've been good to us. Thank you, Father, you've been better to us than we even know how to begin being to ourselves. Glory to your name. There is a name that I love to sing, that I love to sing his worth. That it sounds like music in my ears. It's the sweetest name. Just cry out that name. You ought to just cry out that name, because there's healing in that name. There's deliverance in that name. Salvation is in that name. Deliverance is in that name. Power is in that name. You ought to just cry out that name right there over your situation. You ought to say, situations, I call out the name of Jesus. Whatever you're dealing with, whatever you're going through, just say the name. It's precious if you just call on that name. If you just call on that name. If you just call on that name. Things happen when you invoke the name. Somebody, God's just waiting on you to invoke the name. He's ready to get involved. He's ready to come in your situation. Just say the name. He's ready to turn your life around. Just say the name. He's ready to save backslidden children. Just say the name. He's ready to fix broken homes. Just say the name. He's ready for you to come off the ventilator. You ought to just cry out the name. Cry out the name for somebody you know that's on the vent right now. Say the name of Jesus. It's so precious. All of heaven adores the Lamb who was slain before the foundation of the world. We love you. We love you, Father. Why do we love you? Because you first loved us. It's not about fame or fortune or notoriety, but it's because you first loved us. And you showed your love for us while we were yet sinners. You died for us. Thank you, Father, for paying the price for dying for us. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. You'll just begin to open your mouth and just love on him. Just begin to love on him. Come on, open your mouth and begin to love on him. Not gonna pump, not gonna prime. Man, in this season, you ought to think of the goodness of Jesus and just begin to open your mouth and just begin to worship him. You ought to open your mouth and just begin to whisper to him. Tell him how much you love him, how much you adore him. You ought to open your mouth and just begin to whisper sweet somethings to him. Sometimes he just wants to hear your voice. Not on just Sunday mornings, but he wants to hear your voice. Glory. is so great. Thank you, Father, that I'm a miracle when I examine my life. Come on, you ought to just begin to love on him. You made it through the storm. You made it through the rain. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I won't let the rocks cry out for me. Thank you, Jesus. And we love you the more. And if you love Jesus as Lord, come on, put your hands together. Bless him. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. I will bless his holy name. I will forget not his benefits. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As our worship team comes, glory to his name.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on and let's bless the Lord in this place. Come on. If God has done anything for you, bless the Lord in this place. Stand up on your feet and let's begin to give God glory. Let's begin to tell him how wonderful he is. Let's tell him how marvelous he is, how magnificent he is. Lord, we give you all the glory. We give you all the praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The God that we serve is able to do everything but fail. If he didn't do it, it's not because he couldn't. He didn't do it because it wasn't time. Hallelujah. Lord, we bless your name in this place, oh God. We give you all the glory. We give you all the honor, oh God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're worthy, oh God. You're worthy, oh God. All the glory belongs to you. All the glory belongs to you, oh God. All the glory belongs to you. All the glory belongs to you, oh God. All the glory belongs to you. All the glory belongs to you, oh God. Hey, all the glory belongs to you. All the glory belongs to you, oh God. Come on, lift your voice and help us sing. All the glory belongs. All the glory belongs to you. All the glory belongs to you, oh God. If you believe that, open your mouth and lift your voice. All the glory belongs.
All the glory belongs to you.
It belongs to you.
All the glory belongs to you,
oh God. All the glory belongs.
All the glory belongs to you. All the glory belongs to you, oh God.
All the glory belongs.
All the glory belongs to you.
It belongs to you.
All the glory belongs to you.
Oh God. Come on, lift your voice. We're gonna give him the highest praise. We say hallelujah. Say hallelujah. Say hallelujah. Say hallelujah.
Say hallelujah.
Say hallelujah.
Yahweh,
we praise.
We praise
Yahweh.
Yahweh,
we praise.
We praise.
All the glory belongs to you. All the glory belongs to you, oh God. If you believe all the glory belongs to God, lift your voice and sing.
All the glory belongs to you.
It belongs to you.
All the glory belongs to you,
oh God. Yeah, all the glory belongs.
All the glory belongs to you.
It belongs to you, Jesus. Oh God. All the glory belongs.
All the glory belongs to you.
We give you glory.
Oh
God. All the glory belongs.
Belongs to you.
Oh God. Come on, lift your voice. Help us sing. All the glory belongs.
All the glory belongs to you.
All the glory. Lord, we give you the highest praise. We say hallelujah. Say hallelujah. Say hallelujah. Say hallelujah. Say hallelujah. Say hallelujah.
Yahweh,
we pray.
We praise
Yahweh.
We
pray.
We praise
Yahweh.
Yahweh,
we pray.
We praise
Yahweh. The glory belongs to you, oh God. All the glory belongs to you. All the glory belongs to you, oh God. We bless your name, Jesus. All the glory belongs to you. All the glory belongs to you, oh God. We give you the highest praise, all the glory. We give you honor, oh God. We give you all the glory, Lord. It belongs to you, oh God. You're worthy of all the glory. You're worthy of all the honor, Jesus. We bless your name. We bless your name. You deserve it, Jesus. You're worthy, Jesus. You're wonderful, Jesus. You're worthy, God. Yeah. We bless your name, Jesus. You are here, moving in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, mending every broken heart. I worship you. I worship you. worship you. You are here moving in this place. I worship you. I worship you. Lift your voice, help us sing. Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep. You're the light in the darkness. You're my God. That is who you are. You're a waymaker. You're a miracle work, promise keep. You're the light in the darkness. You're my God. That is who you are. You are here mending every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here breaking every chain. I worship you. I worship you. Lord, you're a way maker. Way maker. Miracle work, promise keep. You're the light in the darkness. You're my God. That is who you are. That is who you are. Who you are. You're a way maker. You're the miracle worker. Promise keep. You're the light in the darkness. You're my God. That is who you are. Waymaker, waymaker, Lord. Miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. Heart fixer, mind regulator, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. Heart fixer, mind regulator, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. Heart fixer, mind regulator, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. Help me say, waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Where would I be without you? Where would I be without you. How could I live without you? I'd be so lost without you. Where would I be without you? Where would I be without you? How could I live without you? I'd be so lost without you. You make my world go round. When it was upside down, you make my world. I'd be so lost without you. Lift your voice and say, you make my world go round. When it was upside down, Lord, when it was upside down, you make my world go round. 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 Round and round and round. You make my world go round. You make my heart sing aloud. You make my heart sing loud, loud. You make my heart sing loud, loud, loud. You make my heart sing loud. Yeah, yeah. You make my heart sing. Heart go round, you make my world go round, round and round. You make my world go round. Where would I be without you? Where would I be without you? How could I live without you? Lord, I'd be so lost without you. Where would I be?
Come on, let's stand all over the room.
You make my world go round.
As the song ministers to you. The question was asked, where would I be without you?
When it was upside down.
And when you examine your life and you look,
you make my world go round.
No doubt in my mind about that question. Without
when
him, I would be lost.
It was upside down.
Oh, somebody needs
you
to release something to
my
him.
World go round.
Bless you, just lift your hands and just release it to him. Your cares, your concern.
When it was upside down.
As you may feel
down.
That your world's upside down right now. The Bible says that when the
you
enemy comes in like a flood, he'll lift
round.
Up a standard. Come on, if you just release the weight, the burden.
When
you lift your hands, you're surrendering all to him. That when you lift your hands, you're just releasing
where
it to
would
him.
I be
that's the question right there. You ought to look down the canons of your life.
Where would I be?
And realize, like Israel, if it had not been for the Lord who was on my
side, you.
Where would you be? You'd be
how could
lost.
Be
you'd be dead. You would have lost your mind. You would have gave up in the struggle. But because of Christ, he held you fast.
I'd be so lost without you. Where would I be?
Sometimes
without you.
Every man, woman, boy, or girl makes the realization.
Where would I be?
Where would I be without you?
Without you.
Cause
you make my world go round.
So Father, we thank you. Even though it may seem like our world is upside down, you're there to meet us with mercy. You're there to meet us. To help deliver us from an upside down world. Father, we thank you that we don't have to fight, that you fight on our behalf. And you declared that the victory is already ours because you're fighting for us. You declared that the healing, all we got to do is confess and declare that the healing is ours because you've already gave it to us.
You make my heart sing loud.
Thank you, Father, that you're dispatching ministering angels now to meet us. To minister to us, no matter what we're dealing with.
You make my heart sing loud.
That even though our world may be upside down, I learned as a little boy, you got the whole world in the palm of your hand.
When it was upside down.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, where would I be?
Just for one more time.
Without you, where would I be?
This is personal reflection time.
Without you, how could I live? Without you, I'd be so lost. Without you, you make my world go round.
Oh, hallelujah. Now clap your hands if you know that he's the center of it all. He's the one who causes your world to go round and round. Go ahead and just wave at a neighbor and tell him good morning. Go ahead and wave at somebody and tell him good morning, good morning, good morning. Hallelujah. Good morning. Put my glasses back on so I can see if y'all frowning up at me. Good morning. Good morning. It's good to be here. It's good to be in the house of the Lord that we could have been anywhere, but we had our minds made up that this is the day that the Lord had made, and I'm going to rejoice. Every day you ought to rejoice and be glad in it, but certainly when we get to come together as a body to worship, we should rejoice. Means to simply have joy over and over and over again. Amen. Amen. Why? Because the joy of the Lord is our strength. And that when you realize that the joy of the Lord is your strength, you ought to want to have joy over and over again. Because even in your place of weakness, He gives your strength. He is your strength. Amen. Well, it's just good to be here. Good to see you this morning. Pray that you had a great week, that you saw God do something this week that you didn't see Him do last week. And this is the first day of a new week. You ought to declare that this week will be a week for miracles. Okay, let me say that one more time. I don't know what you believe in God for, but there's some things that I'm trusting and believing God for before the end of 2020. And I don't know what week is going to come in, but I just say every week that this week will be a week for my miracle. You ought to clap your hands if you still believe in God for Him to do something for you. I'm telling you that you set your faith at the beginning of the year. You set your faith that, God, I believe you're going to get me out of debt. I believe I'm working on getting out of debt. God, you're going to get me a new house. Listen, some of the saints that got new houses this year, amen. Amen. We've had, three, I think, get new houses this year. Was that this year or at the end of last year? I think we've had at least two or three. I know two for sure that we did a house blessing a couple of months ago. Had a call to do another one last week, but it rained. So the saints are still being blessed. Okay, y'all missed it. Y'all got to learn to shout for somebody else's blessing, because your blessing may be next. See, the saints are still being blessed. Folks still getting jobs. Folks still getting promoted in this season where they telling you that the economy is struggling, that folk ain't making, man, God is still blessing those who trust Him. This is still the season where you can see God do the miraculous in your life. I promise you, all you got to do is just trust God. Hold on, grandmama say, to His unchanging hand. The world may change. Mama Duff, the world may change, but God ain't going to change. He's the God that changes not. And if He did it before, come here. Somebody, y'all help me say it. If He did it before, oh, He can do it. Oh, see, y'all, I ain't got the right crowd with me. Okay, all right. I say if He did it before, He'll do it again. He'll do it again. He will do it again. Look back at your life, and that should give you confidence. In the words of the late, great Timothy Wright, he say, He brought me through this. And He brought me through that. And Lord, I'm thankful. There's somebody out there got some this and that things that God done brought you through. You singing like Marvin said, I never would have made it if it without you. I came out that this and out that better, and I came out stronger, and I came out wiser. Just go ahead and wave at somebody again this morning and say, He brought me through this, and He brought me through that. Amen. You don't know like I know what the Lord, you can't even see it. But if I could sit you down and tell you, you cry for me, but I'm crying not because He turned my sorrow into dancing. He's a good God. Amen. Amen. Grateful to God for each and every one of you. It's offering time as we prepare ourselves to give this morning, as we prepare to again trust God with our tithes and our offering. Yes, we believe in tithing. Yes, why? Because tithing is not just the law thing. It predates the law. And listen, if you trust God concerning that thing that belongs to Him, I'm a living witness that if you get seed in the ground, you trust Him just with the tithe. You don't do nothing above the tithe. He's got to honor that. Amen. He said, if you do that, He said, I'll open up the windows of heaven, pour you out a blessing that you have not room enough to receive. And Jesus said, all you got to do is give, and it shall be given unto you. This is why, as a little kid, I never understood why grandmama and them used to say every Sunday morning at offering time, you can't beat God giving no matter how hard you try. The more you give, the more He gives. And all you got to do is just look. Start at Genesis, and you'll see that all throughout the book, God gave. God gave His Son. They called Him Jesus. Yeah, I know. But if you trust Him concerning your giving, Luke 6:38 says that He'll open up the windows of heaven. He'll pour you out not on a blessing that you have not room enough to receive, but he said, if you give, it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Anybody want their cup to run over? I want my cup to run over. I want more than enough for all my stuff. Amen. I need more than enough for all my stuff. And I want some leftovers. We live in a society now where y'all don't like eating leftovers. But there's a blessing in the leftover, because that's normally the best, because the flavor normally sets in. And I need to talk to some country folks. City folk don't know nothing about leftovers. That when you get them leftovers, boy, the best is in the leftover. So as we trust God, come on, let's get our offerings together and let's pray over them. Those of you who are watching us live, they're going to put some information up on for you on the screen. You can give that way electronically. I know many of our millennials, X or Z's, and like to give electronically, and you can do that as well. The buckets are here on the stage if you'd like to give. Where's that other bucket, Brooks? Get that other bucket, put it over here so people don't have to kind of cross mingle. If you don't mind putting that over there in the event that people from this side may not give electronically. Thank you, sir. Amen. Come on, let's pray over our offering. Father, thank you so much for the giver. Thank you so much for the tither. Thank you, Father, that you're going to perform your word in our life. That you're not a man that you should lie, that everything that you spoke shall come to pass. You said before heaven and earth, your word shall not pass away. Your word is what we can stand on. And so, Father, we not only trust you for salvation and what you did for us at Calvary, but we trust you not just for healing, but we trust you concerning our money. That when we trust you concerning our finances, God, that you'll meet our needs. Because you said we are a needy people. And so, Father, thank you that you're giving us more than enough for all of our stuff. Plenty still in 2020. And we give you glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. It's now time for giving. By giving. Amen. Amen. That's the most. I love that part of service. Amen. Amen. We had a friend of the ministry in town this week and stopped by, and he blessed the house. Not only did he bless the house, he recorded a video to put out on his page of people that he encouraged. It's good to have friends and people who believe in what God has put in you. Amen. Not only did he just talk about it, but he wrote the ministry an $800 check and said, keep doing what y'all doing. Keep serving God. Keep saying, okay, y'all put your hands together. He watches us, and he says that he wanted to be a blessing to us. And he said, this ain't the last. This is the first of many. Amen. It's good to know that you have people who trust in what God has put in you. Amen. Amen. I know y'all trust, y'all come and y'all serve and y'all come, know that y'all trust in us, but it's good to know somebody watching us in another state. Trust all that God has called us to do. Amen. 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 Honey, you gonna come this morning and talk about your women's event?
Good morning, good morning, good morning. Woo! I can't get the woo right, but good morning, everybody. It is so, well, I am so glad to be here this morning, which I am glad to be walking amongst the living every day. Hallelujah. Y'all not glad to be walking amongst the living? All right, come on. Amen. All right, so what I wanted to do was get up and talk a little bit about our brunch and paint that will take place on the 21st at 10 o'clock. We do ask that you go to Eventbrite to register. That way we can have a head count so we can make sure that we are practicing the proper social distancing, okay? Because in all things, even though, yes, we want to get together, we are tired of being cooped up in the house, we want to get our women's ministry back up and going, we want to do it the right way. Amen? So we do ask that you go on Eventbrite to register. It is going to be a great time, great food, great fellowship. So there will be sanitizing stations set up in different areas of the room, but if we get our head count, then I know whether we need to transform the youth sanctuary or the main sanctuary. Amen. So we want to make sure that we have proper distancing in place for everyone who registers. So go out to Eventbrite and register for the paint and brunch. You will not regret coming. You will have a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful time. Our artist is such a wonderful, sweet person, and I can't wait for you all to meet her. So I look forward to seeing everyone on Saturday, November the 21st at 10 o'clock. 10 o'clock. Free, 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 free.
Amen. Amen. And I think we got a link also on the Facebook page. You can go and register there as well too. So for those of you who follow the Facebook page, you can register there. Amen, amen, amen. So excited to have our children's ministry back up and going. Amen. Sister Lisa is doing a phenomenal job the past couple of weeks with our young folk. Amen, amen. Praise God for that. And they're learning. A couple of weeks ago, I think, they used spaghetti noodles and marshmallows to do whatever they were doing, talking about, they told me, your body is the temple, praise God. And so what a unique way, a project and activity just to connect with young people at their age. And so again, our children's church, so glad it's up and going to get them acclimated in the things of God at their level. Amen. Amen. And you know that we couldn't allow the women to outdo us men. Y'all know that, right? Y'all do know that, right? Yeah. We kind of got our own little chat. Y'all don't know what we be doing. We the kings, man. We double agents. We flying under the radar. Amen. Amen. But we're going to let y'all in on what we doing because everybody may not know. So we having our Iron Bowl party on the last. Okay, y'all women looking at us like, yeah. But yeah, we're going to have a good time. Madden tournament's going to be going on. They already talking smack about who the greatest. So we're going to make it an eventful day. And so the last Saturday of the month, Iron Bowl Saturday, hopefully we'll get an Iron Bowl. Praise God. Because Auburn, another year of Jesus bragging rights, I ain't going to be able to take it. Praise the Lord. Y'all lost yesterday, even though y'all ain't played. Praise God. Amen. That's for another day, for another time. So men, again, if you're interested in that, throw your hands up. Elder Brooks is going to spearhead our men's ministry, and so he's going to coordinate that. And so you can just let him know if you have not registered in our men's chat, or you may be watching us and you're not a part of our ministry and you like to come. Of course, we're gonna shoot pool. We're going to have our mask on. Of course, you can't eat chicken through the mask, so we'll have to take a mask off, just gnaw on the bone, but we'll practice social distancing and enjoy the presence of the brethren. Amen. Again, my wife says, we're just tired of being cooped up in the house. We want a fellowship. This is what the church is all about, and there are ways we can do it safely. Put on your mask and let's do it. Amen. Let's make it do what it do. Amen. 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 Our church business meeting, again, listen good so that you can come. Of course, we're open and transparent with our finances and what happens here at the church. Our church business meeting, mark your calendars, the second Tuesday of December. The second Tuesday of December. The second Tuesday of December. When is it going to be? The second Tuesday of December. Now, this meeting here is less attended than Bible study. We don't get a whole lot of folk at Bible study, praise the Lord. But the church business meeting be, you know, less attended than Bible study. But this is an opportunity for you to kind of know what we've done as a ministry, what our goals are for next year, what we're gauging toward. Did we meet the mark this year concerning our finances and church growth and so many other areas that we kind of focus on? You get an opportunity to kind of see and meet who are auxiliary heads and over certain ministries within the church that you may want to get connected with. And so the second Tuesday at 6:30, the second Tuesday at 6:30, we'll meet here in the sanctuary, and so we'll have our yearly business meeting. Amen. Amen. The second Tuesday at 6:30. Make sure you're here for that. Amen. Amen. Of course, it's been a tumultuous year. But I think we did better financially, even still with a down year, than we did last year. And it's nothing but the goodness of God. I think, I could be wrong, but I think we did a little bit better this year than we did last year. Amen. And it's because of you. Thank God for you and what you do. Amen. 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 Y'all ready for the word? I'm ready for the word. Amen. Y'all ready for the word? I'm ready for the word, y'all. Alabama and Auburn didn't play today. Why y'all so? You should have a whole heap of energy today. Troy ain't play. Ain't no State, no Tuskegee playing. No Magic City Classic have no y'all. So y'all should have plenty of energy, praise God. Let's get in the word. I'm ready. Father, thank you so much for your word. That your word is life to us, and your word gives life. Because you are the giver of life. And so, Father, because of a relationship with your word, we can receive life. Because of a relationship with Jesus, we can receive life. Thank you for the life that was given so that we could receive life. And it's out of that that our responsibility is to connect others to that life. That though the enemy may come to steal, kill, and to destroy, we realize that you've come to give life to all of those who are connected to you. And so, Father, strengthen us. Give us the ability to come out of our comfort zones and be able to share the uncompromising gift that we receive through a relationship with Jesus. So, Father, I ask that I decrease, you increase in me. Father, none of me, but all of you, ask that you anoint these lips of clay. Give me the words to say, hide me behind Calvary's cross, that they see not me, but they see you high and lifted up, that they hear the voice of God from behind the man of God. Speak, Holy Spirit, now. Give us preaching power in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, clap your hands one more time. Do it for the vine. No, ain't nobody doing that in 2020. Amen. Amen. John chapter number one. Thank God for our first-time visitors, those who are watching us, and those who may be in house. If you would clap your hands, lift your hand if you're a first-time visitor. Lift your hand if you're a first-time visitor. Come on, let's clap our hands for our first-time visitors. Amen. Amen. We welcome you in this morning to our sanctuary and to our live service. John chapter number one. That's the gospel according to John. And so, of course, we've been dealing in a series for the last 5 or 6 months when the pause button has hit. And earlier this month, we wanted to talk about the power of being connected to Jesus. There's so much power in being connected to Jesus. We really don't understand what it means to be connected to Jesus. Jesus says that I'm the vine and you are the branches. Meaning that we can't be one without him. And many of us, I think, downplay our relationship or the connection that we have with God. And because of that downplaying, it causes us to not share Christ like we should. Many of us are where we are in life because somebody shared Jesus with us. And I'm so glad that somebody shared Jesus with me. Because if nobody had ever shared Jesus with me, I would not have received the benefits that come with being connected to Jesus. And so on last week, we started talking about, or 2 weeks ago, whatever Sunday, it's third Sunday, second, so I can't keep up, third Sunday, eighth. And we started talking about the power of being connected to him and understanding what it really means to be connected. Out of that connection to him, it should give us the unction to connect others to him. Because for the simple fact, we don't want all the benefits to ourselves, but that we should want our family, our friends, to be partakers of these benefits. Amen. Many of us, when we find a good sale happening at Walmart, we tell somebody. Many of us, when we find a good meal at a restaurant, we tell somebody. But here it is, we have a relationship with Jesus, and we rarely tell somebody. Don't raise your hand, but I'm going to ask you a question. When is the last time you told somebody about Jesus? I know many of us are going through our own trials and our own tests and our own temptations. And it's in those trials, tests, and temptations we really forget about the mandate that Christ gave us. What mandate, Pastor? That he told them, his disciples, in the very last book of Matthew, he says, go into all the world. And watch this. That has not changed, to tell people about Christ. If the world we live in is going to be changed, if our family is going to be saved, it's going to take you or somebody like you telling them about Jesus. Many of us don't want to step up to the plate because we've made religion so self-centered. I came to talk to somebody this morning and share with somebody that you have a responsibility not to get caught up in your test, trials, and tribulations, but you have a responsibility to tell somebody still about Jesus. I want to tell you this morning that not only have you been entrusted with a great responsibility, you've been entrusted with a great treasure that's been given in earthen vessels. You've been entrusted with something great, something greater than yourself. And in the old church, they used to say stuff like, Lord, lead me to the rock that's higher than I. And when you realize that there's something greater than the world on the inside of you, you ought to want to be overly excited about sharing this good news. Here it is, we're going to find here in John chapter number 1. John, as he's writing his book, he pens these words beginning at verse number 5. And he says, again, the next day after John stood and two of his disciples, and looking upon Jesus as he walked, he said, behold, the Lamb of God. You missed small group Sunday school this morning because we talked about a relationship with Christ, what lordship with Christ looks like. What does it mean to allow Jesus to be Lord of your life? And one of the names that they used for Jesus was Lamb of God. I'm so glad that Jesus was the Lamb of God. Why? You got to know a little bit about your Bible, because the Lamb was slain, Old Testament. The Lamb's blood paid the price for the sins of the people. I'm excited that the blood that Jesus shed some 2,000 years ago. Remember I told you last week there were a couple things that you got to know about. You got to know about the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ in order to share Christ with somebody. And the significance of what it all means, he says, behold, the Lamb of God. And the two disciples heard him speak, John speaking, and they followed Jesus. They left John and they followed Jesus. Then Jesus turned and saw them following, verse 38, and said unto them, what seek ye? What you looking for? They said unto him, Rabbi, which is to say being interpreted, Master, which is another name of Jesus. I'm glad that he is the master of my life. Where dwelleth thou? Where you living at, Jesus? Where you staying at right now? He said unto them, come and see. They came and saw where he dwelt and abode with him for that day, for it was about the 10th hour. One of the two which heard John speak and follow him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first findeth his own brother Simon and said unto him, we found the Messiah. Anybody glad that they found the Messiah? The one who saved you, the one who paid the price for you, that we found the Messiah, which is being interpreted the Christ. Remember, Christ is not his name. Christ is only the title. It's the anointed one. Christ simply means the anointed one, that he walked in the anointing of God. Jesus the Christ. I'm not going to go into it, Ms. Wanda. The means one. The is an absolute. The theology. The theocracy. The is absolute one. The girl. The boy. He is the absolute one. And he brought him to Jesus. And when Jesus beheld him, he said, thou art Simon, the son of Jonah. Thou shalt be called Cephas. Isn't there something about how when you come into a relationship with Jesus, he changes your name? Anybody glad that they transformed from sinner to saint? Y'all quiet in here this morning. Don't y'all shout me down good when I start preaching good this morning. No, he said, the day following, Jesus would go forth into Galilee and findeth Philip and said to him, follow me. Now Philip was of Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip findeth Nathanael, said unto him, we found him. We found him who, of whom Moses in the law and the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. And Nathanael said unto him, can there any good thing come out of West Montgomery, out of East North Montgomery, out of Tulane Colt, Trenum Colt, Shawter, Alabama, on the other side of the train track? Can anything good come out of there? Philip said unto him, come and see. I want you to underline that in your Bible or highlight that in your Bible app. Put that in your notes. Come and see. Jesus saw Nathanael coming to him and said unto him, behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom is no guile. Nathanael said unto him, man, you know me. Jesus said unto him, before that, Philip called thee, when thou was standing under the fig tree. Can I help somebody right here? This ain't even in the notes. I'll give it to you free. Not even what we're going to talk about. But God knows you and your present situation. He knows where you are. He knows your struggle. And he sees Nathanael hanging out under the fig tree. And he saw Philip, tell him, come on, come see Jesus. Nathanael answered and said unto him, Rabbi, thou art the Son of God. Thou art the King of Israel. Just for a little while, I want to hang my hat for just a little while this morning on this thought. Come see for yourself. Come see for yourself. Come see for yourself. This is what the relationship with Jesus should cause to flow out of you when you deal with other people. People look at your circumstances, watch this, and how you deal with what you're going through and how you handle the pressures of life. And you find yourself telling people, if it had not been for the Lord on my side, if it wasn't for this relationship with Jesus, and if you want to get out of what you're dealing with, if you want to know how to handle the pressures of life, come see for yourself. This is a universal term. Watch this. This is a universal expression that can be given to any man, woman, boy, and girl who needs to see Jesus for themselves, to come and see Jesus, the one who died for you. Couple things you need to understand as you look at this text, the breakdown of this entire chapter. Number one, you have to understand the record of Jesus, verses 1 through 14. Then you have to understand the revival before Jesus, verse 15 through 34, that John had a revival before Jesus even showed up. Number three, you need to understand the recruitment for Jesus, verse 35 through 50. All of us are called to lead somebody to Christ. And I think in today's church, we've really taken the focus off others and put them on ourselves. Let me say that one more time. Won't get many amens here this morning, I see, but we've taken the focus off of others and we've put it on ourselves. How selfish we've become. How selfish we've relegated what Christ did for us at Calvary to just ourselves. First thing I want to tell you about this text, as we want to connect others to Jesus, even though we're connected, our goal is to connect others. Number one, there has to be jubilation. They're going to put that up there on the screen for you. There has to be jubilation, excitement about Christ. One, you got to be excited about Jesus. I know, Pastor, you really don't know what I'm going through, Bishop. You don't know what I'm dealing with in life. I can't be excited about Jesus. I can't be excited. But guess what? Jesus was excited about you. While he was still going through what he was going through, he was still excited about you. I know. Y'all want a real feel-good message to make you think it's all about you, boo, but it's not all about you. Verse number 35, he's going to put that up on the screen. He's going to put that up on the screen for you. Verse number 35, watch what it says, the excitement that they had about Jesus. And again, the next day after John stood and two of his disciples and looking upon Jesus as he walked, they said, oh, behold, the Lamb of God. And the two disciples, they heard him, and it's because of John's jubilation, his excitement about who Jesus was, they left John and followed Jesus. How you think Uncle Jimmy gonna stop following Budweiser if you don't tell him about Jesus? Okay, y'all. Okay, Pastor, I can still drink Budweiser and be saved, but you ain't supposed to be getting drunk. Boy, it's gonna be cold this morning. Cold in here this morning. Don't cut the air conditioner on in this Methodist church. Praise God, but it's gonna be cold. And I'm sorry, I grew up Methodist. Praise God, y'all don't. And they turned and they followed Jesus. That was jubilation. One translation says it like this: not only was there jubilation, he said, the following day, John was again standing with two of his disciples as Jesus walked by. John looked at him, declaring, look, there is the Lamb of God. And when John's two disciples heard this, they followed Jesus. And you have to have excitement about your relationship with Jesus. If you're going to help anybody else get saved, as a Christian, you can't always have a woe is me mentality. Oh, Lord, I just don't know how it's going to make it. I'm trying to rub two nickels together to make a dime. The change in my pocket rustling just to make a quarter. We got to have excitement even in the midst of what you're going through. It may not look the way you want it to look. It may not. Your health may not be as well. You got to still be like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. That's the, okay. You got to still be like the three Hebrew boys. Even if he don't deliver me, even if he don't heal me, even if the power get cut off, even if the car get repoed, God is still able. You have to have excitement about Jesus. If you're going to connect somebody, somebody say, I got to be excited about him. Second thing today we'll see from this text is there has to be conversations with Jesus. You have to spend some time talking to God. I don't know why we only talk to God when we're in trouble. Okay. We only talk to him when we need him. That's kind of how my children kind of treat me. They only kind of talk to me when they need me. No. Baptist. That's how we do God. We only talk to him when we need him. They know I'm just joking. But that is how it is, kind of, sort of. I'm going to keep him look this way so I don't see it because it can't stand him. But we only treat God like he's a 911 operator. Wait till we get in a tight. Wait till we get in a fix. And we call on Jesus and he comes to our rescue. There has to be conversations with Jesus. I hear about this at the lunch table today. I done got in trouble. Okay, Courtney kind of looked at me. Verse number 38, there has to be conversations with Jesus, talking with Jesus. Verse number 38, they're going to put that up there on the screen, and it reads on this wise. Look what it says. Look what it says. Y'all ready? Y'all ready? Y'all with me? Then Jesus turned. He saw him following him. Said unto them, what you looking for? They said unto him, Rabbi, Master, where you living at? Where you dwelling at? And he said unto them, come see. Come see for yourself. Come see for yourself. They came and they saw. And they spent some time with him. When's the last time you spent some time with Jesus? I knew when the Lord was dealing with me on this, this wasn't going to be an easy message. But when's the last time you took a little time and spent with Jesus? There has to be conversations with Jesus. Oh man, God help me, help me. If they're going to help lead somebody to Jesus, if they're going to help connect family, friends, and others to Jesus, they got to talk with Jesus. You got to learn of Jesus. You got to take upon his yoke. You got to learn who he is and what he's done for you and the price that he's paid for you so that you're able to go and share it with somebody else. One translation says they remained with him the rest of the day. When's the time you just cut off the cell phone, television, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Snapchat? When's the last time you cut it off and just spent the day with Jesus? Here it is, third thing we must learn about this text this morning. Third thing that we must learn about this text that was information, news about, information regarding Jesus. Verse number 42, word was beginning to spread that the Messiah had shown up. Verse number 42, and why would it say, and Jesus, watch it, y'all watch it. Look at the text real good. It's there in the text. It's there. If you're looking, don't go to sleep on me. Don't lose out. One of the two which heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. If Simon had not heard the word, Peter would not have preached Pentecost. Y'all quiet in here. You are where you are because somebody else told you about Jesus. You are who you are in Christ because somebody heard about Jesus and they told you to come see for yourself. So watch what he says. He first finds his own brother Simon. This is where you ought to be able to take. You ought to be able to reach your own siblings. He didn't go find a perfect stranger. He went to his brother and said to him, we found the Messiah, we found the Christ, and he brought him to Jesus. And when Jesus beheld him, he said, "Thou art Simon, you a sinner. From this day forward, you're not going to be a sinner. You're going to be known as a saint. From this day forward, you're not going to be known as an adulterer. You're going to be known. You're not going to be known as a drunkard. You're not going to be known as X, Y, and Z, but you're going to be known as a saint. You'll be known as Peter." And I'm so glad that a relationship with Jesus has the propensity to change your name. Don't let nobody tell you what you used to be. Don't let them put that burden over your life that you used to be this, but thank God for Jesus. Yeah, thank God because I went and saw a man for myself, because I went and met this man for myself, because I developed a relationship with this man for myself. I ain't what I used to be. Somebody ought to clap their hand because they ain't what they used to be. That I'm glad I'm not what I used to be. I ain't what I need to be, but I ain't what I used to be. Don't allow people to attach stigmas to you based on what you used to do, because all of us got some used to do in us. Y'all quiet in here. All of us got some I used to do. I used to smoke an ounce, baby. I used to get down with the get down. I got some used to. Don't let people convince you of what you used to be when God has called you something else. This conversation with Jesus, Peter found his true identity, and your responsibility is to help lead somebody to the place where they find their true identity. Because Peter found out who he was, he called him Cephas, and Cephas simply means a rock. He found out that he was the stone, but he was not the stone. He had a relationship with the stone. He had a relationship with the chief cornerstone. He said, "Thou art Peter, and you are a rock. You are a rock, but guess what? I am the rock." That's why grandma say, "Lead me to the rock that's higher than I." Not only should you have jubilation, you should be excited. You should have conversations with Jesus. Not only should you have information, news about Jesus in order to connect people to him. The fourth thing that you should have, you should issue invitations from Jesus. You should issue invitations. You should issue invitation. Verse number 43. Y'all there? Y'all ready? Watch what he says. He's going to put that up on the screen there for you. He's going to put it up. I think he got it up there by now. Verse number 43. "At the day following, Jesus would go forth into Galilee and findeth Philip, said unto him, Follow me. Now Philip was of Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter." Philip. "Findeth Nathanael, said unto him, We found him of whom Moses in the law and the prophets did write, this Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." And you ought to be glad that there is an invitation, that an invitation was issued to you to connect people to Jesus, that an invitation was issued to you that connected you to Jesus. He said, "Come on, see this man." This man from the city called Galilee. Not only should you have jubilation and excitement, you should have conversations. Not only you should have that, you should have information. Not only you should have invitations, you should invite somebody to follow Jesus. Promise you, if I could sing it, I'll tell you that Jesus was the best thing that ever happened to me. I just need about two or three people to testify that Jesus was the best thing that ever happened to me. I mean, that he was the best thing. If I had not met this man, if I had not got an invitation to follow this man, I wouldn't be the man that I am. I wouldn't be the woman that I am. I wouldn't have the benefits that I have. But because I came and I saw him for myself, ain't nobody can tell me nothing about him, because I seen him for myself. I know the Lord for myself. Is there anybody that can testify that when they came into a relationship with Jesus, that when I saw him for myself, my life was transformed? And guess what? If you don't know him, I'm going to give you an invitation to know him, because he's able to transform your life. Last thing I want to tell you this morning, so get ready, cut across the field, make my way to the house, put my feet up, watch the Steelers play today. Fifth thing I want to tell you, not only should you have jubilations, excitement, conversations, information,
about Jesus and an invitation from somebody to connect them to Jesus. The fifth thing that you have, if you're taking notes, that there should be investigations for Jesus. Sometimes being nosy is a good thing. Sometimes being nosy for Jesus is a good thing. Go to verse number 45. Put it up there on the screen, and we're going to walk this thing out. Verse number 45, we're going to walk it out. Watch what he says. And Philip now findeth Nathanael. Some of you going to see yourself in the shoes of Nathanael. And he said unto him, we found him of whom Moses in the law and the prophets did write. We found the Messiah. We done found Joseph, boy. We done found Jesus of Nazareth. And Nathanael said unto him, can there any good thing come out of Nazareth? Can I tell you right here is, it doesn't matter where you come from, but when you come into a relationship with Jesus, he can take you from the guttermost to the uttermost. He can take you, in the words, I think that's Drake, you can start at the bottom. Y'all quiet in here. Y'all didn't think Pastor knew anything about that. Started from the bottom now here. Y'all. And because I started from the bottom and now I'm here, you ought to be able to reach back. That's the problem with some of us. We get up and get on our feet. God get us into a place. We don't reach back and bring nobody else along. You selfish. Look at somebody and tell them, don't you be selfish. You got to reach back and you got to grab somebody else. You got to be able to grab somebody by the hand and pull them along the way. You got to issue them an invitation and you got to cause them to be nosy for Jesus. Look at the text and I'm ready to leave you alone. Look at what the text says in verse number 46, the text says that, and Nathanael said unto him, can there any good thing come out of Nazareth? And Philip said unto him, come and see for yourself. Look at somebody and smile at them with your eyes and say, baby, you ought to see it for yourself. You ought to see what he's done for me. You ought to see the miracle he's worked out in my life. You don't know who you're sitting next to, baby. If I didn't go see a man, if I wasn't like the woman who was at the well, if I wasn't like that woman, he told me my whole life story, you need to come down here and see for yourself, because he can read your newspaper to you. He can read your diary. He ain't in your room. He can tell you your whole life story. He can tell you your ups and he can tell you your downs. Baby, he can heal your body. He can put you on a rock. He can establish your going. You need to come see for yourself. Look at somebody and smile at them, wink at them real good and say, you need to see. Matter of fact, just give them a fist bump. Just fist bump them. Don't touch them. Give them a fist bump and tell them, you need to come see for yourself, because you need to see what the Lord is able to do in your life. Watch what he says. Jesus said, saw Nathanael coming to him, and he said unto him, behold, he's an Israelite. You got to do your research on that. Ain't got time to spend there, because I'm already, ain't got but 2 minutes. I got to get ready to get out of here. In whom there is no guile, ain't no guilt in him. And Nathanael said unto him, whence knowest thou me? And Jesus answered and said unto him, before that Philip even called you, come on, LG, I'm ready to go. He said, I saw you broke. Okay. I saw you busted and disgusted. I saw you in your sick state. I saw you when you was on the verge of losing your mind. I saw you when your hair was getting ready to fall out. I saw you when the cares of life were getting ready to choke you out. I saw you when you were going through what you were going through. And I'm so glad that Jesus saw me, that he saw me. He told me my business. He told me what I was going through, and that he saw me. Is there anybody in here that can testify that I'm glad that he saw me, that he sees me? Watch this. I ain't perfect. I ain't got it all together. I'm still going over there to see him, because he's got to read my business. How many know that when he reads your business, he'll get you right? That when he reads your business, he'll get you right. That when he reads your business, he'll get you right. You ain't got no trust but to follow a man who don't know you. You ain't got no trust but to follow a man who tells you all about your business. You ain't got no choice. Look at somebody and tell him, you ain't got no choice. If you come see for yourself, he'll change your life. Is there anybody in here that can testify that because I saw him for myself, he changed? Come on, son, that he changed my life? life? Is there anybody in here that can testify that he'll change your life too? Is there anybody in here that can testify to a dark and dying world that the wages of sin is death? But if you could get connected to this man, he'll give you life forevermore. Is there anybody in here that can testify that the thief came to steal and to destroy me? But because I was connected to Jesus, I'm still standing tall. If you know you're still standing tall, you ought to stand up on your feet and say, because I met him, I'm still standing tall. That the storms may blow me to the left, but they may blow me to the right. I may have to lean with it, and I may have to rock with it. I may have to bank head bounce on it. That's old school right there. But when the storms of life come, I just bounce a little bit. I sway a little bit, but I'm still standing on the word of the Lord. Is there anybody that can testify, because I got connected to Jesus, I'm still here. I'm still standing, and I'm standing on the word of God, that I'm standing on his word. Go ahead and fist bump your neighbor and tell your neighbor, you got to keep standing on Jesus. You got to stay connected to Jesus. That if you're going to help connect somebody to somebody to Jesus, you got to get real rooted in the word of God. You got to study more. You got to pray more. You got to fast more. You got to spend more time with him. And because these disciples spent a little time with Jesus, they set the world on fire for the Lord. Because they spent time with Jesus, they set the world on fire for the Lord. Let me say it for a third time. Because they spent time with the Lord, they set the whole world on fire. Because they spent time with the Lord, their family members got saved. Because they spent time with the Lord, their friends got saved. Because they spent time with the Lord. And I want to encourage somebody, you need to spend time with God. If coronavirus ain't caused you to spend more time with God, I don't know what's wrong with you. I don't know what's wrong with you. But because I met this thing called corona, it's called me to spend more time with God. It's called me to trust him more. It's called me to stretch my faith out on him more. It's called me to be on fire to tell people about Jesus. And here's what you gotta do in life. You gotta tell people about this man called Jesus. The man who hung for me. The man who bled for me. The man who died for me. But you can't leave him dead, because it was 3 days later. The Bible says that he got up with all, feel Baptist today, with all power in his hand. Go ahead and shout, power is in his hand. Go ahead and shout, power is in his hand. And the praise team told us, if your world is upside down, just keep your hand in the master's hand, because he'll turn things back up again for you. Even though your money may went down, but he's able to restore unto you everything. Somebody shout, everything that the devil stole, God will give it double, because I'm connected to Jesus. Here's what you gotta do. You got to get folk connected to Jesus. The text says they was walking with John. But when John pointed to Jesus, say, behold, that's the Lamb of God. Here's what John was saying. He takes away the sins of the world to me. Dave, here's what he was saying. Here's the Lamb. He's going to deliver you. D, here's the Lamb, Brooks. And if you get connected to him, he'll set you free. Ella, if you just get connected to him, he'll walk with you. He'll talk with you if you just get connected to him. Here's what the story says. They were disciples of John. But when he pointed to the master, here it is. If you don't hear nothing else I say, you got to point people to the master. Don't point them to your troubles. Yeah. Forget about your story. Everybody got one. Everybody got a story to tell. Stop pointing people to your story. point them to the master. You'll find out. And as you point people to the master, he'll fix your story. 2,000 years later, we're still talking about these people who pointed folk to the master. He took 12 men, turned the world upside down because they got connected. Here it is, second thing I want you to walk away with today. You get connected to him, get hooked up, tied up, wrapped up, tangled up in him. Pastor, that's just too much. No, that's what, if this season hadn't called you to the place of I need him every day, like the old folk used to say, I need him every day, I need him every hour. Lord have mercy, I need him. I'm not even talking about from a sin standpoint. Yeah, we need him for that. I'm not even talking about that. But I'm just talking about just to stay safe. I'm talking about just to stay sane. I'm talking about just to stay sanitized, just to keep me in my right mind. Don't get caught up on your story that you don't point people to the master. They walked away from the first preacher. They started following the Messiah. Today I want to challenge you. All heads bowed, all eyes closed. I can't see you. If you got them closed, open them anyway. Praise God. And believing God to heal my eyes, he gave me glasses. And that's my healing. I receive it. Somebody may be watching me right now. You need to be connected to him. You've heard today, you heard last week. Somebody watching me say, preacher, I hear what you're saying. I hear what you're saying. I gotta get connected. It ain't about, listen, we love to have you in the church. We love to have you join our church. We love to have you be a part of our community, be a part of our extended family. But it ain't all about that. There's some folk that connected and ain't to the house, but ain't connected to Jesus. Some people go to church week in and week out, but don't know Jesus. I want to talk to somebody this morning, whether you're in this room or heads bowed, all eyes closed. Listen, you raise your hand. I can see that. I can see that. I can't see if your eyes closed, but I can see that. But if you need salvation, just slip your hand up. I want to be saved. I want to get connected to Jesus. I guarantee you he'll change your life. I ain't going to tell you that every way is going to be easy. I'm not going to tell you that the crooked place is going to be made straight right away. But you just keep on trusting him. He'll fix that. We serve a God who may not come when you want him. That's you and you want to get saved. Slip your hand up. It's real simple. It's a judgment-free zone. We don't judge nobody around here. We all need Jesus. If you're watching and you need to be saved, don't be afraid. Put it in the chat. I want to be saved. We want to connect with you. You simply, I want to be saved. And all you got to do is say, Father, I'm a sinner. I need Jesus. I want to be connected to him. I believe you. You sent him, he died. I believe that you rose him from the dead on the third day. I need to be connected to him. If you said that prayer, you're saved. You're fit for heaven as I am. Secondly, you're saying, Pastor, I want to come back to him. I know him. Life threw me some curveballs. You know what I'm saying, preacher? Yeah, I know what you're saying, boy. That one pitch I couldn't hit when I played baseball. Curveball get me every time. But life threw you a curveball. And you hadn't rebounded and you walked away. But you want to come back to Jesus. You can just slip your hand up if you're here this morning. Slip your hand. I want to get reconnected. I want to come back to Jesus. Praise God. I see you. I see you. I see you. If you're there and you're watching, type it in the chat. I want to get connected to him. Come back to him. He never left you. He's been waiting on this moment, this hour, this opportunity for you to hear this fat preacher tell you that you need to be connected. He's been waiting
I have to find something else to say because I'm losing weight. I ain't going to be able to crack fat jokes on myself no more. But this fat preacher told you today you need to be connected. Praise God. Thirdly, you're saying, preacher, I'm saved, man. I hear you, man. I'm connected. But I need a church family. If you're here, you can slip your hand up. I want to be a part of your church family. Thirdly, if you're watching us, people connect virtually to us. And I take the honor and privilege of serving the people in house and out house as their pastor. Wherever you are, near and far, you can connect with us. If you're in here and you want to be a part of our family, you can slip your hand up. You can slip your hand up. I want to be a part of your family. I want to be a part of the house of God. I want to be a part of Kingdom Seekers family. I'm like Uncle Sam. We need you. Father, those three things that we just asked, pray for those as the voice of the Holy Spirit is now moving, in the midst, in the ears, in the spirit of thy people. Father, that they who have made the decision to get saved, we thank you, Father, that they're part of the family. If they made that decision, they want to be. Thank you, Father, if they made the decision to get reconnected to you, because there's power in connection. God, we notice in the text that you didn't tell Nathaniel all about his problems. You didn't even care why he was hanging out under the fig tree. But you're just glad he came to you. And today, Father, we're glad for these that have raised their hand and who are watching us virtually that have come to Jesus just the way that they are. You'll work everything else out in their lives. Holy Spirit will work all that out. Thank you for those who decided to connect, and the Spirit may still be moving on their heart. I'm going to put a number up for you to connect with us. Put that up, leave that up. We pray for them, Father, who may want to be a part of this family. We give you glory for them. Thank you for your word today, because your word is life. Thank you, Father, that your word is strength to our weak bodies. It's strength to our weak spirits. That even in the midst of what we're going through, hearing what we hear, Father, we're going to trust you. You hadn't failed us yet. We've come this far by faith, leaning and depending on you, trusting in your holy word. You've never failed us. You won't fail us. So, Father, we pray a hedge of protection around all your people. An angelic host and camp around us, just like it was around Job. That you're sending ministering angels now to minister to us. That they're ascending and descending to and fro heaven. With our cares and our blessings. Father, thank you. And as we prepare to leave this place, that we pray, God, not only an angelic host, but we pray that the blessings of Abraham be upon your people. That they're blessed beyond measure. That they're blessed beyond conditional or where they are right now in life. That they're blessed to be a blessing to somebody else. The greatest blessing that we can share is Christ. May the blessings of Joseph now be on your people. Father, they may feel like they're in the pits, but you can take them to the top. You can put them in the palace. Thank you, Father. We pray and we ask, God, that you send the spirit of Joel, that you release the spirit of Joel in this place, that you pour out your spirit among your people. We need more of your spirit in our life. We need the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives, moving, functioning, breathing through us. And now, Father, as we lift our hands to receive the benediction, thank you, Father. Now unto him who is able
to keep us, to present us faultless before the Almighty, all-wise God. That there be glory, power, dominion, honor, henceforth, now and forevermore. Father, cause your face to shine on us. Lift your countenance up upon your people. Give us peace. In Jesus' name. It's in that name that's above every name that we pray. It's in that name that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord. It's in that name that we pray. And everybody that loved him as Lord said amen. 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 Come on, clap your hands. Clap your hands. Celebrate him. Celebrate Jesus. Come on, wave at somebody as you prepare to leave this place. God bless you. Have a great week. We love you. Virtual hugs, virtual kisses. Blessings of the Lord be upon you. Have a great week.